The electric universe paradigm has an unparalleled record of successful predictions in the space age. In stark contrast, as telescopes have improved and covered more of the electromagnetic spectrum, astronomers have become more perplexed by exoplanets, stars, and galaxies that shouldn't exist. A few brave souls have declared cosmology to be in crisis. But at no time has the belief been shaken in Einstein's gravitational cosmology and its meaningless Big Bang expanding universe. Now, 21st century technology has built and prepares to launch the James Webb Space Telescope, also known as the JWST or Webb Space Telescope. It's described by NASA as the largest, most powerful and complex space telescope ever built and launched into space. It will fundamentally alter our understanding of the universe. But fundamental changes in understanding are subject to the dead hand of academic peer review, which is governed by a coterie of top experts who have a great deal to lose if they don't control the consensus narrative. So there has been no substantial change in our understanding of the universe since the middle of the 20th century. Instead, the narrative has simply become more and more complicated as barnacles of ad hoc theory have encrusted the Titanic of institutionalized science. Fundamental changes break the consensus. They're the icebergs awaiting science's Titanic. So fundamental changes almost always come from individuals on the fringe. The field is wide open for the successfully predictive electric universe cosmology to be critically tested by the new Webb Space Telescope. NASA states, quote, "The Webb Space Telescope is an orbiting infrared observatory that will complement and extend the discoveries of the Hubble Space Telescope with longer wavelength coverage and greatly improved sensitivity. The longer wavelengths enable Webb to look much closer to the beginning of time and to hunt for the unobserved formation of the first galaxies, as well as to look inside dust clouds where stars and planetary systems are forming today." End quote. Observe, this aim is unscientific and therefore unlikely to fundamentally alter our understanding of the universe, since it presumes only the consensus Big Bang gravitational paradigm for study. We've seen that to maintain this narrative, there has been an endless introduction of ad hoc forces, particles, and impossible objects like neutron stars and black holes. Meanwhile, in the 1960s, plasma cosmology was introduced by Hans Alfvén, a plasma scientist who won the 1970 Nobel Prize in Physics for his research. Plasma cosmology is a model of the universe in which plasma and electromagnetic forces play a dominant role on the galactic scale. It's based heavily on observation and experiment, but due to specialism in the 20th century, it's studiously ignored by astrophysicists. They ignore Alfvén's Nobel speech warning that their treatment of space plasma as a mysteriously magnetized fluid is fundamentally flawed. Meanwhile, plasma cosmologists produced the spiral shape and non-gravitational rotation of a classic spiral galaxy experimentally and with supercomputer models. When they included the weak force of gravity in the computer models, it had no appreciable effect. Such experimentation and simplification are hallmarks of classical physics. Galaxies are governed by electromagnetic forces, not by gravity. Well-organized galactic magnetic fields have more recently been mapped and conformed to plasma cosmology. Such fields are unexpected and unexplained in gravitational theory. This alone knocks out the gravitational foundation of Big Bang cosmology. Imaginary black holes and dark matter are not required. All we know about the force of gravity is that Newton's law operates within the present orderly solar system. We can't presume peacefulness in the solar system for most of Earth's history. That's merely wishful thinking and flies in the face of geological evidence of past global paroxysms. And the notion that Newton's law of gravity and the gravitational constant as measured on the Earth applies universally is characteristically geocentric and myopic when you consider our short history and the discovery that gravity theory doesn't work at the galactic scale. So let's first get Big Bang history right. The Belgian priest astronomer Georges Lemaître is usually identified as the first to theorise that the recession of nearby galaxies can be explained by an expanding universe. Einstein is supposed to have said, and I quote, "This is the most beautiful and satisfactory explanation of creation to which I have ever listened," end quote. But we can forget Einstein. He did away with the force of gravity and tried telling someone who has just fallen over that it was the Earth's warping of space-time that told him to hit the ground. 2 years after Lemaître's epiphany, Edwin Hubble provided evidence that the velocity of a galaxy away from us increases with its distance from us, a property now known as Hubble's law. The Hubble law implies that the universe is expanding, but that simply assumes the redshift of faint galaxies is due almost entirely to the Doppler effect, which is the increase in wavelength and consequent lowering of frequency of the light from a fast receding object. Mathematicians jumped on Hubble's law for their new creation myth by retro-calculating to a point origin in a magical Big Bang. They now tell us with religious fervour how the universe began and how it may end. What we are not told is that Edwin Hubble termed his famous discovery a, quote, "redshift versus apparent distance relationship," end quote. Wisely, Hubble didn't accept his discovery as proof the universe is expanding. Rather than signifying that some faint galaxies are accelerating away from us at a good fraction of the speed of light, Hubble maintained that it was likely some new physics was involved. This was later proved by the astronomer Dr. Halton Arp, who became known by his followers, including some leading astronomers, as the modern-day Galileo, following his banishment by the mathematical priesthood of Big Bang cosmology. Like Galileo and Hubble, Arp worked directly from telescopic observations. He studied the photographic plates and lined his office walls with images of galaxies. He produced the Atlas of Peculiar Galaxies. By careful observation, he found physical links between high-redshift quasars and low-redshift active galaxies, which proved Hubble was right. High-redshift is not evidence for an expanding universe. Arp's research into high-redshift quasars shows they are local. The universe is of unknown age and extent and is essentially static. A Big Bang never happened. The origin of the universe, if that has any real meaning, is well beyond our present deeply flawed science. Let me explain quasars. When discovered in the early 1960s, quasars were utterly mysterious. In 1963, the Dutch astronomer Martin Schmidt solved the mystery of quasar spectral lines when he discovered they were highly redshifted. This placed the brightest one, 3C273, about 1.5 billion light-years away. The radio astronomer Gerard Vasseur wrote, quote, "What could possibly look like a star, produce tremendously strong radio waves, resemble double radio galaxies, and yet produce so much energy? The full mystery of the quasar becomes more profound when all the information is considered together. They are very far away, and the luminous cores are very small. At the distances inferred by the redshift, quasars emit the energy equivalent of 100 billion stars like the Sun, all the energy being generated in a volume of space not much larger than the solar system." End quote. To make matters worse, it was found that quasar 3C273 underwent sudden changes in brightness over a period of 80 years. Vasseur notes, quote, "This incredible discovery was also completely unexpected," end quote. The sudden changes in brightness were found to be associated with blobs of matter being blasted out in jets at irregular intervals. At the assumed redshift distance of the quasars, those blobs were apparently moving faster than light. Halton Arp published a paper in 2007, Quasars and the Hubble Relation, in which he states, quote, "A continuity exists in redshift from the highest redshift quasars to low redshift ciphers, active galaxies and allied galaxies. Evidence is discussed for this sequence to be an evolutionary track with objects evolving from high to low intrinsic redshift with time. At the end of this evolution, the objects are nearly the same age as our own galaxy. End quote. In the case of quasar 3C273, the odds are 100 trillion to 1 against Arp being wrong. Remarkably, Arp found the quasar's redshift decreases discontinuously in quantized steps, and their mass and brightness increase as they move away from their parent, slowing down to eventually form companion galaxies. Quantization of redshift verifies that it is intrinsic to the matter in the quasar rather than anything to do with the light on its journey to the Earth, which solves most of the quasar mysteries at a stroke. They are not at the edge of the visible universe. They are local, small and faint and not moving faster than light. Arp's evolutionary sequence adds a pleasing biological nuance to plasma cosmology, which instead of a black hole, has a donut-shaped electromagnetic plasmoid at the galactic centre. The plasmoid is formed by electric current fed radially into the galactic centre, in the case of a spiral galaxy, along the spiral arms. The current produces the ordered galactic magnetic field. A similar plasmoid produced in a laboratory is the most extremely compact and complex form of electrical energy storage known. The lab plasmoid is formed by a radial plasma discharge between a central conductor and a concentric outer conductor, which mimics plasma cosmology's galactic circuit. Laboratory plasmoids are observed to emit intense beams of neutrons axially as they lose energy. The electric universe model proposes that when the energy density inside the surface of the plasmoid nearest the axis is sufficient to form neutrons from protons and electrons, the neutrons escape axially from the plasmoid's intense magnetic field to subsequently decay into a beam of electrons and protons. On leaving the active galactic plasmoid, the light electrons spiral in the galactic magnetic field more than the heavier protons. The result is an electron-deficient smaller plasmoid, or quasar, jetted along the active galactic plasmoid's umbilical intergalactic Birkeland current. The coaxial galactic Birkeland current, identified by its magnetic field structure, acts like a cosmic dense plasma focus. Mapping the magnetic field in a jet along one of these intergalactic Birkeland currents has shown the current to be on the order of 10 billion billion amps. The knots seen in galactic jets are embryonic galaxies. The electric universe further explains Arp's quantized redshift and increase in mass and brightness of quasars. The umbilical galactic Birkeland current has an axial current surrounded by a more negative current cylinder, rather like a cosmic coaxial cable. It effectively imitates the dense plasma-focused device's structure. Electrons from the cylinder flow radially into the axial quasar, powering its embryonic plasmoid and, quickly at first, increasing the charge polarization of its subatomic particles and, consequently, its particles, energies and masses, in quantized jumps. That gives rise to its increasing brightness and the quantized decreases in redshift and slowing of the quasar due to conservation of momentum. Arp's discovery demonstrates a galactic-scale quantum effect. In summary, the active galactic nucleus is the plasmoid womb and origin of the jets and the matter forming quasars, or embryonic galactic plasmoids. This simply explains the phenomenal jets and radio lobes of both parent and child. Halton Arp's research showed sensibly the universe is of unknown age and extent. It is not collapsing under gravity or mysteriously expanding. As nature repeatedly demonstrates, it is in balance. Arp realized this raised a serious issue because it implies that gravity between celestial bodies must be repulsive. Otherwise, balance is impossible. Of course, this is completely counterintuitive because we experience gravity only as an attractive force. but there are historical precedents for a theory of repulsive gravity, which was first proposed in the 1690s by Nicolas Fatio de Douillet and considered at the time by Sir Isaac Newton. Arp studied a later theory known as Lesage's theory of gravity. Theoretically, it works by a shadowing effect under bombardment from all directions by strange high-speed particles, but no plausible particle impact mechanism could be found. However, as I've argued in the past, gravity is a subatomic dipolar electric force, which for all celestial bodies has one pole facing outwards and the other inwards. It's equivalent to having spherical magnets with the same surface polarity. This sidesteps the problems with Lesage's theory. We experience gravity as an attractive force simply because we are as much a part of the Earth as are the air, rocks, and water. We are polarized within the Earth's gravitational sphere of influence, like iron filing stuck to a magnet. The James Webb Telescope has the power to see fainter redshifted quasars more clearly than before. So my first prediction is that the James Webb Telescope will support Halton Arp's research, which shows plainly that high redshift quasars are born in pairs and emitted in oppositely directed jets along the spin axis of a low redshift active galaxy. They are not at the edge of the visible universe, they are in the neighbourhood of their parent galaxy. Therefore, they are not incredibly distant, bright and large. There is no superluminal motion. They are nearby and youthfully faint. By carefully tracking quasar redshift evolution, we will see the transformation from a naked, high-velocity and low-mass plasmoid to a low-velocity, high-mass companion galaxy. Experimental tests of active galactic nucleus behavior by plasma cosmologists should be possible using the dense plasma focus device. In other words, a return to real physics. Theoretical physicists, on the other hand, have failed to self-correct their theories for a century. It is time for plasma and electric universe cosmology to explain Halton Arp's universe. Thank you.